Dear participants, now welcome you all in second session of this 1 week AICT faculty development program. For this second session of this faculty development program today, we have very experienced resource person today, Professor NVR Jyoti Kumar. Professor NVR Jyoti Kumar is a name that we are well aware of. He is a senior professor and head of department in the Department of Commerce, Mizoram University. Sir is the former dean, School of Economics, Management and Information Science in this university. Professor Jyoti Kumar, with his teaching and research experience of more than 36 years, has published more than 70 research papers and book chapters in national and international journals of repute and in edited books. Sir has also authored 4 books in his long prosperous career. Professor Jyoti Kumar has been serving numerous committees, and some of which to be named are Academic Council, Mizoram University, IQAC, Finance Committee, NAC Steering Committee, and others. Professor Kumar is member of Board of Studies and School Board in several universities. He is also serving as a member of Editorial Board for the Mizoram University Journal of Humanities and Social Science. Sir has been very active in guiding academicians and thus has delivered lectures as resource persons in several orientation programs, refresher courses, conferences, and workshops. His expertise is in marketing, service marketing, media marketing, organizational behavior, and entrepreneurship. Today, we are privileged to have sir here in this AICT Atal Faculty Development Program. So, on behalf of Department of Tourism and Hospitality Management, myself, and all participants, I request sir to bless us with his lecture. So now, over to you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Pankaj, for your introduction. And I am very much thankful to the Department of Tourism and Hospitality, Dr. Himanshu Raut and his team, for giving me this opportunity to interact with young faculty members, research scholars, and also postgraduate students of different universities and colleges. And I know this is the first day, and I am the second speaker, and I have to play a special role. In the form of setting a proper stage for effective interaction in next 5 days that would come. So the topic given to me is the topic given to me: needs of entrepreneurship and process of building entrepreneurs in tourism and hospitality. It's like a cut and razor. This topic looks like a cut and razor. And I'm happy to interact with more than 200 budding research scholars and young faculty members. And before starting my presentation, I would urge each one of you to be very careful about your health and the health of your loved ones in family and in our friends circle. Because the kind of crisis, health crisis, or the kind of health emergency we are facing today in the world, it is a worldwide phenomenon, kind of global phenomenon. And once in a century type of thing is happening now. So we should be very careful about ourselves and our health and others' health. So please take care. And this morning when I started opening the Google a Google Doodle came. You might have experienced that they designed a special Google Doodle today, and they are thanking the frontline warriors who are fighting against this pandemic, COVID pandemic, including the teachers and those who are taking care of children. So my greetings to the teachers, my fellow teachers. You are in teaching profession, and I'm also in teaching profession. I might be having a few more years of experience by virtue of my age, but we are in the same boat, and we are in the process of teaching learning process. And actually, and unfortunately, this pandemic, COVID pandemic, has affected every sector, unfortunately, including education. We all know we are missing our students, we are missing classroom fun, we are missing face-to-face interaction, we are missing campus life, fun, cultural programs, sports, sharing the lunchbox, and beautiful domestic fights with our colleagues and friends. All these things we are missing. And our students, I know our students are also missing us very much. Though we are able to teach online, and we are able to conduct examinations online, and they are missing us very much. The 10 days holidays, 2 weeks holidays, unexpected holidays, when we got in the month of March, all of a sudden, then initially we thought it's like unexpected paid holiday, right? Our students were a little bit happy publicly, and secretly we were also felt it's like unexpected holiday, right? But after 2 weeks, after 2 months, after 4 months, after 5 months, we don't know when we are going to meet our students and when we are going to meet our colleagues in the department. When normalcy would happen, restored, we are very much uncertain. So please take care of yourselves, friends. And without taking much time, this is like an introductory lecture. Please remember, though this is the second lecture, you may consider this as introductory lecture, touching upon tourism, travel, hospitality, and its status as industry, right? Worldwide as well as Indian context. So these are the main contents: tourism worldwide, statistics and facts. Then tourism entrepreneurship, what is this concept? And what is entrepreneurship? Why entrepreneurship? And who are these entrepreneurs? What role they are expected to play in the business, in this particular tourism sector? Then is it so difficult to start a business? Why still, despite having a better ranking, we are improving, India is improving its ranking every year in terms of ease of doing business. And we have more number of entrepreneurship courses in our curriculum nowadays. And the students have a lot of they have a lot of aspiration to go for MBA programs, MCOM programs, and business related programs. But still, when we ask our students in general, I'm telling, when we ask our students to opt for entrepreneurship, there would be some hesitation. Why entrepreneurship? Because it is all risky. People would say, I don't have much money. People would say, I don't have much experience to do business. So these myths we are going to discuss in this session. Then we would also touch upon the impact of COVID, especially on tourism sector. We all know tourism sector is one sector which has been affected adversely all these years. That we are going to discuss. And I would like to end this presentation with the way out. What are the possible solutions, right? And well, this is and before starting this slide, I would like to request the participants, if you want to share your ideas or if you want to ask any queries, please post your query in Q and A. box, and I would like to spare at least 20 minutes time towards the end to discuss about your queries, right? Let me continue now. So this is tourism industry worldwide. Why tourism is a different industry? In fact, because it is not one clear product. What is the product? What is that we are going to sell as a marketer in tourism sector? What is that we are going to sell? Because tourism touches upon many industries from technology point of view, from manufacturing point of view, from the skills required by the personnel working in different related sectors. They look like transport, travel industry, lodging, the firms which provide lodging, hotels and restaurants, and there are many more. More includes entertainment, recreation, fun making, moving around the places, going to a movie theater in a different place, right? And going to the beach, enjoying your next birthday in some other place, somewhere in the God's own country, Kerala, and attending a wedding, a friend's wedding, in some other neighboring state. And of course, because of COVID, we are not able to do all these things. We are confined to our own homes. We are confined to this work from home concept has been developed, right? And initially, when organizers planned this program, they wanted to have this program with a limited number of participants as per the guidelines given by AACTE. AACTE, Atal Faculty Development Program, we should say that it is going to help us very much to interact with ourselves and to refresh our knowledge, right? But then normalcy has not yet restored. Now the advantage of this online system is now 200 plus participants, they are able to make themselves as academic community, though they are operating from their own home, from different states. There are many cost advantages, of course, right? So a lot of cost is not, it doesn't involve a lot of cost. Possible to interact with so many resource persons, right? And without much cost. So this is one advantage of this technology, online technology. So what is this? What is this product? What is it? It is not one clear product. We all know we studied services marketing, and we studied marketing. We studied CRM, customer relationship management, right? But try to apply all your marketing concepts. Try to apply all your marketing techniques to tourism sector. Tourism, like any other service product, tourism is an intangible product. It is intangible, and it touches upon many sectors like transport sector. And again, within transport sector, there is a water transport, there is a rail transport, right? And there is air transport, which has been affected adversely in this pandemic time. Right, different types of transportation facilities we have, and similarly travel firms, right from Indian Railways to a luxury bus to reach one particular nearby destination. There are huge transport facilities available, and when we move out of our place, then we need good food, we need shelter, we need lodging, we need entertainment, and we want to go for shopping. We want to enjoy the local flavor in terms of their customs, in terms of exposure to their culture. What happened to all these things since last March, right? Then this is about statistics and facts about global. Before going to discuss about this, just I want to again touch upon this particular concept of product. And as you know, in case of a service, right, and unless customer participates, it is not possible to create a service. because services are intangibles and products are tangibles. Customer participation is very much important in case of services marketing. Tourist destinations are there everywhere. What is the problem? We are not able to have experience because we are not able to travel. We are not able to go around. So if we confine to our own homes without moving out of our home, then it is a tourism sector, it is a travel sector, it is the food industry, it is the restaurant business, it is a general shopping. These are the industries which are going to be affected. Please remember, if we stop going out of our home for a few days, if not months, then the whole economy is going to cripple. That is what we are experiencing nowadays. Well, then this is about statistics and facts about the global scenario. Total contribution of travel and tourism, it is $9.25 trillion in 2019. That was a normal year. COVID was not there. COVID's impact was not that much visible in 2019. So we would say that was a normal year. No new normalcy happened that year, right? And the number of international tourist arrivals, it was 1.46 billion in 2019, and global leisure travel spend $4.71 billion in 2019. This is the overall global scenario about the tourism sector. Here, tourism, though I mentioned tourism, normally tourism includes travel sector is different, tourism sector is different, but sometimes when we say tourism, it includes travel also. Well, then there would be a question like, which are the countries with the highest share of GDP 2019, right? That means these countries actually have you ever come across these names? Macau, Maldives. Of course, Maldives may not be very strange name, a strange name. Aruba, Seychelles, British Virgin Islands. They are not very popular, right? Because these are actually, these are not very big countries. They are very small countries. And most of these countries, most of these nations, they are islands only. For example, Macau, where it is? It is a Chinese special administrative region on the south coast of China. So it is a top country, small country, right? And tourism accounted for half of its GDP, followed by Maldives. Where is this Maldives? It is an independent island country in the north central Indian Ocean. Aruba is an island and a constituent country of the Kingdom of Netherlands. Seychelles, this country consists of 1,500 islands, lies 1,500 kilometers east of mainland Africa. Of course, these are very small countries. But now, just imagine what would be the fate of the economies of these countries when there is no travel, when there is no tourism. Then, in terms of direct contribution of travel and tourism to GDP, these are the leading countries in 2019. And this is in terms of US dollars in billions. So these are the topmost countries, tourism, travel and tourism, they account for in absolute figures. Right, in absolute figures, travel and tourism, their contribution is like this: US 580 billion US dollars, followed by China, Germany, Japan, Italy, France, UK, and India. And here we know China and India, they are comparable in terms of the size of population. But if you compare China and India, you see China is almost earning four times almost earning 4 times higher than India in terms of GDP. Of course, US, it is a top leader, and other than China and India, Japan contribution is also high. TNT's contribution to Japan's economy is also high among Asian countries. And other countries, Germany, Italy, France, and UK, they are European countries. Then this is the statistics relating to capital investment in travel and tourism in leading countries in 2019. US 2009. So see, if we want to support any industry, right? If we want to make any industry to grow, to survive, to sustain, to grow, right? Then it requires investment. And travel and tourism is no exception. And just to see, these are the countries, where travel and tourism's contribution to GDP is the highest, as visualized in the last slide. But please, still, these are the countries which are providing, they are showing commitment in terms of spending the capital investment in travel and tourism. US, China, and India is not that bad, right? France and Japan. So market size of global hotel industry, and hotel industry is again different because, you know, tourism, travel and tourism, it touches upon many sectors, and hotel industry itself is a different industry, though it is very much related to travel and tourism. So as per 2018 statistics, its market size is global market size is $600 billion. And global inbound tourism by transport mode in percent. In case of air transportation, it is 58%, road transportation 37%, water only 4%, and railways just 2%. But what happened after COVID, during COVID, what happened to these sectors? This sector, air 58%. Global inbound tourism, it is very much affected now. And flights are running below the optimum capacity. They are running, but are they making money? Are they making money? People are scared of going to airport. People are scared of going to, what to speak of airport? People are scared of going to even the village which is closer to you. So, then this is a selected leading cities ranked by number of cultural attractions. See, cultural attraction is one important area of research. And those who want to pursue their research in the field of tourism, and they can focus their research on these cultural attractions. We like to move around. We like to go to new places. But certain places we want to go again and again. Again and again, people are ready to go there. And what is this cultural attraction? And these are the number of cultural attractions: Tokyo, Paris, London, New York. Then I try to get what type of cultural attractions they had in their countries. I try to get some information through Google Guru. And in case of Tokyo, it is mostly like religious sites, neighborhood, art museums, historical museums. These are the cultural attractions they have. And in case of Paris, which is known as the City of Light, open air museum, very popular there. And of course, as you know, Eiffel Tower, right? But these are the number of attractions, cultural attractions they have in the whole city as per these statistics. And similarly, London, similarly, New York. Right? Then, what about the tourism sector in India? This is an overview of tourism sector in India. And as of 2019, tourism sector created 4.2 crore jobs. And almost 10% of total, that is equivalent to 8 to 10% of total employment. And this is the target by 2028. the sector is expected to create 5.23 crore jobs. So these statistics would reveal the importance of tourism, travel and tourism sector and hospitality sector in terms of providing jobs, because that is one of the important area, and that is a priority of the government, that is a priority of the central government, state government, that is a priority of universities, right? That is our national priority, creation of jobs, and tourism sector has that capacity. But again, I'm asking a question, what happened during COVID? And India ranked third among 185 countries. Very attractive statistics we have. Our rank is third among 185 countries in terms of travel and tourism's contribution to GDP in 2018. And India ranked 34 travel and tourism competitiveness report 2019, according to what is this WEF, World Economic Forum. Then I try to know about this type of competitiveness report. What is this competitiveness report? And we need to improve our competitiveness. And this competitiveness index was first developed by World Economic Forum in 2007. And they first published this competitiveness report in 2007. And please remember, it is not about tourism attractiveness. The purpose is not to know which tourism destination is more attractive. That is not the purpose. The purpose is, it is about developing a business in travel and tourism industry. Which location, which tourism destination has more attractiveness to do business in the field of travel and tourism? So, please remember, like any other business in travel and tourism and hospitality sector also, there is a severe competition between different tourist destinations. We need to promote our own destination. We need to promote India as a destination, and within India also, there are many tourism departments, there are many tourism ministries, there are many state governments which are trying hard to promote certain their own state. And within the state also, there is competition among various tourist spots in a particular state. So we need to, there is severe competition that exists between the nations and within the nations, within the nation also, between the different tourist destinations, there is severe competition. So governments nowadays, many state governments, right? They're trying to improve their competitiveness. Then what is this competitiveness? It is a kind of overall index, World Economic Forum, they designed this competitiveness index, and the overall index depends on three things, regulatory framework, whether the laws, L-A-W-S, the law, the legislative framework which you have in your state, whether it is conducive for entrepreneurs who are going to set up their ventures there or who are already there. Regulatory framework, business environment and infrastructure, whether the state government or whether the tourism department has commitment to deploy funds to employ capital on infrastructure development, and what type of business environment they want to create, right? Then third thing is human, cultural and natural resources. Certain places, they are blessed with certain natural resources, just like in the case of our northeast states, especially Mizoram, Meghalaya, Sikkim. So do you think the tourism department here, they wanted to have hills and mountains and trees and natural forests here? We are blessed with those things. Natural blessings, right? And human factor is also very much important. Whether the people are ready to accept new faces every day, what is their approach, what is their attitude? Whether people are afraid of seeing new faces every day, if people have that type of hesitation to meet new people every day, then somewhere that particular region, that particular city is lagging behind in terms of hospitality. Right? So human, cultural, and natural resources. So these are the things. So you can get more details if you go to WEF or competitiveness report, right? You will get more details about this. Then India was globally the third largest in terms of investment in TT with inflow of $45. And that is equivalent to 5.9% of total investment in the country in travel and tourism. Then, whatever we discussed so far, it is all about the an overview of tourism sector from global perspective as well as from Indian perspective. Please remember, for some of the faculty members, for many of the faculty members, they may look like just fundamentals, right? And I'm not here as a teacher, right? But whatever I'm sharing, in order to do justice for the theme of the workshop, because this is a second class only on the first day, just I want to give some introductory kind of whatever I know, whatever I collected, I just want to share with you. Please remember that I'm not here just to teach something which you don't know. Well, this is, what is this concept? Tourism entrepreneurship. Tourism we know, entrepreneurship we know. Then what is this tourism entrepreneurship? It is the backbone of tourism related industries. Please remember. And we have seen there are certain countries which are doing very well in terms of tourism and travel management. And we all know that for their success as tourism, ultimate tourism destinations, for their success, we should give credit to the entrepreneurs there. Entrepreneurs play a very important role. And we all know tourism is a kind of product. The product is the experience co-created by the tourists. Like other type of services, tourism, in case of tourism also, as a service product, tourists, they play a role of co-creators because their participation is essential. The sceneries which we are going to see in various locations, they are available in internet. Why to go there? Because we want to, and a lot of knowledge we understand about those locations, lot of information, right? It is already available in Google, then why to go there? Travel, mobility, movement, mingling with people, being part of the local people, indigenous people, that gives a different experience. So we don't want places actually, we want experiences as tourists. And customer participation, tourist participation is essential. And that is missing during COVID time. Then WTO's report reveals, and 2015 report, I'm telling about WTO's 2015 report on tourism. In that report, they mentioned these words, job creation, talent development, employment, revenues, very frequently they used these words. But if you want to search for certain words like entrepreneurship and entrepreneurial activity in 2015, WTO's report on tourism, and very difficult to get these words. And according to some research studies, these two words were totally absent. 2015 was not very far away. I mean, far back, right? So that means somewhere, no, we are not giving the due importance which we need to give to the entrepreneurship and entrepreneurs in tourism sector. Well, then what is this? The outcomes and achievements of tourism are attributable to MSME and big companies. Please remember. We all know MSME, micro, small, and medium enterprises. In India, we classify our our small enterprises in any sector, including tourism, as micro, small, and medium enterprises. Very recently, Government of India has made some amendment in the classification of micro, small, and medium enterprises based on certain parameters. You please go ahead. And big companies. But please remember, according to statistics, according to research studies, 70 to 75% of enterprises, entrepreneurs that are in existence in tourism sector in India, they belong to MSME sector. They are not very big companies. Please remember, they are not very big companies. Our tour operators, their size, they are very small. Their size of investment, capital investment was very small. The number of people employed by each enterprise may not be very big in number. It is not like automobile sector. It is not like a steel plant, right? And they are tiny. There are many micro, small, and medium enterprises which would account for around 70% of total entrepreneurs in the sector. So, and we all know MSME sector, especially during this COVID times, it is one sector which has been devastatedly affected, including tourism and travel. And tourism enterprises, they provide products and services in facilitation, transportation, attractions, accommodation, catering, and travel-related retail businesses. So, how many types of businesses are there? You just imagine. Would you imagine you go to Varanasi, you go to Tirupati, you go to Calcutta, you go to Goa, you go to Delhi. Just to imagine this city without transportation facility, the attractions are there, but we want to go there, we want to spend some time there. And accommodation is required, food is required, shopping is required. We want to spend money. Not now, not during new normalcy, right? Now, even though hotels are being opened, restaurants are being opened, flights are being operated, people are very much scared of moving out. Even to meet, I met my parents in last January. I belong to Andhra Pradesh. I've been working in Mizoram University from 2004. Under normal conditions, I would have gone there at least twice during last 10 months. But I don't know whether it is possible for me to go there in next 10 months. Many quarantine rules are there. Flights are getting cancelled. And health risk is, health hazard is there. That is a big factor. And SOP, the words like SOP, the words like quarantine, containment, pandemic. These are the words which we never used to listen. But these have become common man's words nowadays. Every house, these words we are hearing every day, right from grandparent to child. Everyone is, they are using these words very easily and liberally. And this is affecting our tourism sector. We are scared of going out, even to meet our own people. And one important factor is, it is not only going to the places, not only going to destinations, and nowadays, the activities which would involve gathering of many number of people, it is also very much curtailed. Wedding is a big industry in India. Wedding functions, they support tourism and travel sector. They support hospitality sector. They support food sector. They support restaurant sector. They support function halls. Marriages are happening, but someone has to do research. Whether number of marriages have been declined last 10 months, someone has to do some research. But even if marriages are happening, there is restriction. We should not involve more than 50 people. Or three families, four families, if they combine together, it would be more than 100. Then you see, just because of that, this travel and tourism sector is very much affected. Just I'm giving one example. And people, there are certain international universities. There are certain universities in America, in Australia, right? And those universities, some of the universities, they are over dependent. They are very much over dependent on foreign students, and especially China and India. From China, these are two highly populated countries, China and India, and we used to contribute a large number of students to universities that are located in Germany, in UK, in America, in Australia, and in New Zealand. Now their fate is under uncertain. It is under uncertainty, their fate. And they are asking the students, please join our universities. We will allow you to go for online. You want your brother to study in American university without going to America, right? Without going to America, you should learn everything online, like you are learning and I am learning, okay? And what fun is there? What is so great about that? And people are reluctant to join in foreign universities through online mode. Because people want to go to America, people want to go to Australia and Germany, not just for a degree certificate. As part of their career development, they go. As part of their personality development, they go. As part of their employment, they go. They want to get some employment for settlement, they want to go. If that is missing, just for the sake of degree, you want to acquire a foreign degree, a degree from a foreign university through online without going to the foreign country. Now what happened? So sometimes we move to the places for our employment, for the purpose of our occupation, for the purpose of our career development, for the purpose of our studies. But please remember, directly or indirectly, we are helping travel and tourism, knowingly or unknowingly. Well, so such business activities, the activities which are performed by micro, small and medium enterprises and bigger companies in travel, tourism and hospitality sector, they are not an act of nature, but the act of tourism entrepreneur. Tourism entrepreneur is the hero. Tourism entrepreneur should be the hero. And he is in a helpless situation now. He is in a helpless situation. And we all know in economics, we studied four factors of production. Of these four factors, the most important factor is not land, not labor, not capital, but it is entrepreneurship. Fourth factor, we consider it as organizing or entrepreneurship. And it is the entrepreneur who would combine, who would harness, who would make use of land, labor, and capital. Now our laborers, you know, hundreds of laborers, they left the places. They left the places and they lost faith on the system. Very difficult to get back those people. Now we have opened some of the shops, some of the enterprises, except cinema halls and schools and colleges, we have almost opened everything, but they are suffering a lot for two things, because they are not able to get their skilled laborers, because they are not there in the place. They already left, first thing. Second thing, customers are coming out of their home, but they are reluctant to go to a hotel. They are reluctant to travel. Unless there is some personal urgency. Even if there is some personal urgency like a funeral, people are trying to avoid going to funeral. Because we have SOPs, we need to honor SOPs. And there is a fear factor. Fear is the biggest factor. Fear of death is worse than death. Somewhere I read, fear of death is worse than death. That fear complex is there. People would give some examples, like some statistics, like in road accidents, so-and-so number of people would die every day. Due to cancer, so-and-so people would die every day. Due to some other problems, health problems, people would die every day. Then why people are so scared of corona? Still, people would people they like to compare with some other countries. Their death rate is very high, and their death rate is very less. One economist he said, a single death is also a big tragedy. A single death is also a cause of it is like a big tragedy for that family. If there is a single death, then it is a tragedy. But if there are 1 lakh deaths due to pandemic, then it is statistics. Then we speak in terms of statistics. Like out of this much population, only 1% of deaths are there. Only 0.52% deaths are there. It is too less compared to this population. But you convert that 0.52% into absolute figure, it would come to thousands and lakhs. So this is the problem now. This is the problem the entire economy, the global economy and Indian economy are facing. And it is tourism and travel sector which is going to be affected very much. Well, then, what is entrepreneurship? Who are entrepreneurs? There are various definitions. Just I mentioned a few definitions, right? I might have missed some well-known names also. Cantillon, Joseph's Computer, Peter Drucker, right? Ishrich and Peters, Shane, Zimmerer, and so on, right? I'm not going to discuss about the definitions given by all these people, but I want to focus some of the features of entrepreneurship, and these are some of the features of entrepreneurship, the creation and recognition of opportunities. What entrepreneurs do? Entrepreneurs, they either identify the opportunity or they try to create an opportunity earlier than others, better than others. If we have that capacity, we call it a third eye, creative eye, third eye, right? Lord Shiva used to have that eye, but he used to use that eye to punish the bad people. That is a different story. But if you have that, we call it fifth sense, right? If you have that ability to spot out a business opportunity from in a given situation, then we can say that you have that ability of entrepreneur. So the creation of new businesses in conditions of risk and uncertainty to make a profit, that is a simple meaning of any enterprise. So entrepreneurs, they try to create a new business in conditions of risk and uncertainty. Risk is a different term and uncertainty is a different term. There is a difference, right? It is possible for you to measure risk, but it is not possible for you to measure uncertainty. Insurance companies, they are ready to give policies to cover your risk, but they are not ready to give any policy to cover the uncertainty. Now the problem is not risk, the problem is with uncertainty. This pandemic, it created health risk, that is fine. But how long it will continue, that is all about uncertainty. That is a big question mark. But please remember, under normal situation also, entrepreneurs, they should face risk and uncertainty, and finally, their objective is to make money. Well, then, these are the key features. Business opportunity recognition, innovation, risk-taking, idea creation, creativity, achievement orientation, resourcefulness, right? They sound better, no? I don't think you are listening to these words first time, because we teach all these things in entrepreneurship paper. Business opportunity recognition, innovation, risk-taking, idea creation, creativity, achievement orientation, resourcefulness. Who are entrepreneurs? A person who carries out commercial innovation, modification of existing knowledge and our practices. Innovation should be commercially viable. Commercial innovation means, right, I may be having a fancy idea. We didn't imagine some 3 decades back or 2 decades back that it would be possible. Some 3 decades back, now we never, 200 plus people are there on this platform now. We never imagined that 200 people could make a group, and it is possible to communicate with each other through video conferencing. At least some three decades back, it was a crazy idea. But someone got that idea. Now, you know, many people, some of my colleagues were telling, right, in some other colleges, some of my colleagues were telling, we never heard about Zoom. We never heard about Google Meet some 6 or 7 months back. But nowadays, it has become part of our daily life. It has become a part of our daily life. And they didn't expect that they would get a lot of demand for their services now. There are many services which have been adversely affected due to this corona, but there are certain businesses which are doing very well thanks to corona. These online platforms, digital platforms, and wherever it is possible to obtain services and goods without meeting people, such type of businesses have a lot of future. Corona has made us to learn certain lessons also. Future also, please remember, hopefully there might be some vaccine. Hopefully this pandemic would be over, this story, this fearful, pandemic, it will be killed due to some certain tika or something like that, maximum within a year, right? But still, please remember, those businesses where it is possible to operate through Internet of Things, through AI, artificial intelligence, without depending on many people. Just like, you know, there is growing demand for ATM machines now. People, they don't want to go to bank, because why to contact the people? So such type of businesses would flourish. So if innovation is successful, it leads to state of creative destruction. What is this? If innovation is successful, it leads to a state of creative destruction. See, entrepreneurship is a big subject, right? Normally, basics of entrepreneurship we teach for an entire semester, just for basics of entrepreneurship. Just have taken the meaning of entrepreneurship as per my liking. And salute to Joseph's computer. You know, Joseph's computer, I just want to say something about computer, because he is the man who proposed innovation theory of profits way back in 1940s, right? So this theory, you might have studied in economics, and this theory gained popularity over the period of time. And computer's theory of innovation of profits, so they say, he tried to give explanation for the cause of profits. Profit is the cause, right? Profit is the effect of any of two things, at least. What are those two things? And it's not possible for you to make money, to earn profit, unless you reduce your cost of production. Your cost of production should be lesser than the cost of production of your competitors. If you are able to do that, how you are going to do that, I don't know. Through new technology or newer way of method of doing business, or by depending on cheaper raw material, or by engaging cheaper laborers like outsourcing, which how the software companies are doing now. Whatever may be the method, if you are able to reduce your cost of production compared to your competitors, then we call it is innovation. We call it is innovation. There is another choice. If you are not able to do that, don't worry. There is another choice. You have another option as an entrepreneur. Try to improve your revenue. Try to improve your demand better than your competitors. Don't bother about cost factor. Other side of the coin, try to raise your revenues by creating customers, by making customers buy more, or by creating new customers. You are able to do that. How we are going to do that, I don't know. But then we say, if you are able to do that, that means there is some innovation in what you are doing. That is the meaning of innovation according to Joseph. I'm not telling all these things. According to Joseph Schumpeter, right? Then what is this concept, creative destruction? What is this concept? It looks like creation we know, destruction we know. And Joseph's computer, he says, innovative entrepreneurs, their function is to indulge, to involve in creative destruction. They try to destroy the existing practices. They try to destroy the existing products. They try to destroy the existing businesses and industries. Destruction is a bad thing. Destruction means what? Destruction means losing jobs. Many people lose jobs. If businesses are destroyed, if industries are destroyed, then many people would lose jobs. But he says that is the job of the entrepreneur. Then how to destroy the existing systems, the existing businesses, the existing products by creating better ones. By creating better ones, carbon papers we used to use when we were students of BCom, we used to buy carbon papers. Where are the carbon papers available now? Where is the photographer now? Where is the conventional photographer with a camera and a reel? We used to upload a reel, camera film. What happened to those people now? What is this product, a smartphone? Is it a phone really? It is a phone, but it is not only a phone. It is everything nowadays. It is a music player. It is a notebook. It is the internet. It is your computer. It is your bank. It is your class also nowadays. So many, many new features have been added to the mobile phone. See, the mobile phone, which was there some 20 years back, and the mobile phone, which is available now, and the mobile phone, which is going to be available in next 20 years, name may be the same, but technology is totally different. So when you create certain new things, better things, right, then suddenly the existing companies, the existing industries would be destroyed. And he says it should happen, and it will happen. And who will do that? It is entrepreneurs. Is it not happening now? But we have to salute Joseph Schumpeter, because he told these things way back in 1942. And the book written by him was Capitalism, Socialism and Democracy. That is the title. Just go to the Google. Try to get that book. Try to read original books. My younger colleagues, my suggestion to you is, try to read original books. Then we understand their importance, their vision, their foresight, and all those things. Joseph Schumpeter, he was born just a few months before famous economist Keynes. They were contemporaries. They were contemporaries. A few months before only our Schumpeter was born. But you know, they were like opposites. Their theories were like opposites. And being a famous economist those times, John Maynard Keynes, he said it would be healthy for the business people, it would be healthy for the businesses if they maintain static equilibrium. If businesses are in static equilibrium, then that is a healthy thing, that is good, he said. But you know, Joseph's computer said that entrepreneurs should not do. They should try to be in inequilibrium. Inequilibrium is good. Business cycles, you know, he also mentioned about this computer, he also mentioned about business cycles. He said, if certain businesses are dying, that is a good thing. And innovative entrepreneurs, they try to kill certain businesses by creating better ones. Okay, even if you create some better product, then your competitors, they would imitate your product, they would imitate your brand. Then what will happen? Then you will lose your profits, you will lose your competitive advantage. Then what the entrepreneur has to do? The entrepreneur has to try to create something more. And it is a continuous function of an entrepreneur. And those entrepreneurs who are able to create better things, who are able to do their business, who are able to run their businesses in a better way, they are able to survive. They are able to kill the existing practices, existing businesses, thereby creating better ones. Please remember, the top businesses which are there in the world, the top billionaires, the entrepreneurs who are whose worth is billionaires, right? And imagine those businesses were not there some 40 years back. Those businesses were not there anywhere, like, you know, selling books without having a bookshop. Selling books without having a bookshop, that is what Amazon is doing. So when that man started, in 1995 only, 1994-95 only, when he wanted to have that idea, I want to sell books without opening a bookshop, many people had laughed at him. And he started that business in his garage, car garage. Now he is the number one man owning Amazon. That is the example of creative destruction. Well, I would not stress more than this. Innovation could occur in five forms according to his computer: offering a new goods, services. I would stop now in 2-3 minutes. Then some question session will be there. Offering a new goods, services, new production methods, new sources of supplies, new markets, new distribution systems, and new management techniques. I'm happy some participants have raised their hands, and I would answer. Please mention your query in question and answer box, and I will try to conclude in 2-3 minutes. Then we will have some interaction. Okay. Do you have these entrepreneurial characteristics? Try to inculcate these entrepreneurial characteristics in our students. It is a big service to the nation. Entrepreneurs should be a catalyst. You should have full perception and deep understanding of industry environment. You should have learning curiosity in the hard way. You should have certain competencies and skills. You should have capacity to reduce uncertainty. Tenacious and persistent, funding is important, and he should have capacity to ask certain questions himself, some uncomfortable questions he should have capacity to ask himself, right? Then these are 7 myths about starting a business, according to certain research studies, right? These are 7 myths about starting a business. You have to know what you are doing, no need at all. It is not possible to know what you are going to do next 10 years, next 20 years. We don't know anything. Difficult to predict the future accurately. You have to have full business plan. No need at all. You have to start at the right time. Every time is right time. There is nothing like right time. There is nothing like, you know, sometimes we have a lot of beliefs, sun signs, right? No. You have to have a lot of money to start, not at all required. The wealthiest, the richest entrepreneurs today, they didn't born with silver spoon. And you have to hire staff, not required, not so many staff are required. We have to work 24/7. No, you need to be a smart worker, need not be a very hard worker. And you have to do it all, not required, not possible for you to do everything. But you should understand what you could do and what you could not do. Try to outsource certain things from others, right? Then COVID impact on tourism. This is a big area, and here are some statistics. Tourism in India, right? This is about general statistics about tourism sector in India. Then COVID impact, you know, this is the impact of COVID on tourism sector. Just latest statistics I want to share with you. You may be having all these things, right? FTA means foreign travel arrivals. Foreign travel arrivals, right? Foreign exchange earnings, FEE means foreign exchange earnings. And especially these are the states which depend heavily on foreign tourist arrivals, Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu, UP and Delhi. 60% of FTAs, no, they go to these places. They are very much affected now. And so this is my email, and because you people are the important stakeholders in higher education system, as young faculty having a lot of future, and there are some research scholars available, right? And if you want to share anything with me, I may not be in a position to answer many queries depending on time, but please don't hesitate. Let us have a continuous relationship, and I don't hesitate to spare my time for the purpose of your career, and let us have friendship. This is my email, and I once again thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity. Thank you for your patient listening.
Thank you very much, sir, for your insightful discussion about the topic. I'm very much confident that we participants have received a lot of information and knowledge regarding the entrepreneurship and in the area of tourism and hospitality industry. Sir, many of the participants have asked two questions. Some of the questions. One participant, Hari Krishnan, is asking that please highlight the role of government organizations for entrepreneurship development in this during this pandemic or after this pandemic for revival of tourism and hospitality. So what kind of initiatives the government organizations or the related organizations, institutions should take, should initiate for development or revival of this tourism and hospitality?
Yes, that is one question. Shall I answer now or?
Yes, sir, please.
Okay. As part of Atmanirbhar Bharat, government had their own initiatives. And very recently, I wrote an article in one Telugu newspaper, leading the newspaper, Eenadu. A few days back, I published one article. And MSME sector is very much affected. Not only tourism, and MSME sector is very much affected, and the big problem they are facing nowadays is they have to operate below their break-even point. They have to operate. That means if they start doing their business, they have to lose money. And some of the enterprises, they're finding it very difficult to get back their skilled laborers. Whether it is construction or whether it is hotel business or travel management, right? And even if you want to operate your bus for a nearby town, and you have to follow SOP, and if only half of the seats are you are supposed to sell only half of the tickets without raising the fare. If you raise the fare, then there may not be demand also. So these are the some of the problems, and it is not that easy actually. And one problem, government has certain schemes, and they want to extend certain loans, but they want to extend loans for those people who come under NPA, who come under NPA. Those who are able to repay their loans, they don't come under that category. That is one thing. And another practical problem many people are facing is that they are not registered. Very difficult to identify who is the entrepreneur now, especially in MSME sector, because they are not in government records also. So these are some of the practical problems. Actually, they are suffering very much, and moratorium also, government recently took a decision to extend it, right? Government is trying, but this what government is doing is not so sufficient to make them revive. Okay.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Sir, one more participant is asking for one question. Sir, how to inculcate the zeal in students regarding tourism entrepreneurship when they are firmly believing that the industry is sinking fast with no uncertainty of regeneration?
Entrepreneurship inculcation, actually, we all know about Maclelland, who contributed theory of achievement motivation. So we all know that entrepreneurs are made, they are not born, right? And according to him, childhood is a very important stage where it is possible to inculcate achievement orientation. If they have that sense of achievement orientation, whatever field they choose later on, and they would be very successful. And Maclelland also mentioned about the characteristics of achievers, right? And he also mentioned if they are exposed to the literature with achievement orientation, then such type of children, they would develop some entrepreneurial zeal. That is his study. And we all know there are certain communities, there are certain societies, right? There are certain states where entrepreneurs, they flourish a lot. It may be Gujarat, it may be community-wise, we should say Punjab Sikhs, right? They are very, and Parsis, Marwadis, right? And Andhra entrepreneurs, there are certain examples. And Udupi hotels, right? There are certain examples, right? So why there are a lot of production of generation of entrepreneurs in certain communities and in certain regions, because the society also plays an important role. Not only school and college, societal values, right? You know, I would like to give one girl, one of my friend, Francis son, and he's a budding entrepreneur. I know he started earning a lot of money also before this COVID, right? But he found it very difficult to get a girl as a bride, because in my home state, Hyderabad, right, and Andhra Pradesh, many girls in meritorial columns, they wanted to marry a software engineer, but not an entrepreneur. So this type of values, this type of attitude, what kind of attitude and what kind of support, what kind of thing, and Gujarat girls, they don't think like that. They don't give much importance for a person who is working in a government sector. So it depends on the type of values and ethos of the society. That would play more important role than, of course, as teachers, we have a role to play. But by the time the student reaches the graduation and post-graduation, I would think that the game would be over. But still, we are trying in the form of having some incubation centers, right? We have some incubation centers and startup movement is there, right? So people would like to do some job if they don't get any job. If that is the kind of thinking, then that is not entrepreneurship. That is not real entrepreneurship. Okay.
Thank you, sir. Sir, lots of questions we have from the participants. But sir, okay, along with the questions, we are getting a lot of appreciations regarding your lectures. So I would like to share some of the appreciation, like Dr. Smita Mahapatra, is writing, "Thank you, sir, so much for information about enterprise development and tourism sector." Sir, now one last question I would like to take from the questions of the participants. One question is that what kind of tourism entrepreneurship potentials, tourism and hospitality entrepreneurship potentials are in Northeast and especially in Mizoram? What kind of development or what kind of initiatives should be taken by the community as well as by the government?
This is in relation to development of tourism sector here, right?
Yes, sir.
In fact, Northeast, leave Assam, Assam is well connected. Out of 8 states, if you leave Assam, there are 7 more states. And these 7 states are very small states. We call it a paradise unexplored, right? Paradise unexplored. And I used to speak to some people in tourism sector in government also. My friends are there. Is any problem is there? So we don't want to develop. And based on my scholars' research and based on my experience here, I would feel that we don't want to develop mass kind of large scale tourism here. But there is a lot of scope for adventure tourism, eco tourism, natural tourism, and spiritual tourism, right? There is a lot of scope because we don't have a lot of capacity and we don't have required attitude also to go for a mass scale tourism. Connectivity is also a problem. But on the other hand, we don't want to destroy the natural resources here by inviting hundreds of tourists every day. So that is why, except Sikkim and except Meghalaya relating to Shillong, other states really they don't want to encourage tourism on a large scale.
Okay. Thank you very much, sir, for your insightful discussion and answers for the questions from the participants. Thank you for giving us time from your busy schedule and delivering this lecture. Now, as we are reaching to the end of this second session, now we are going to pause this session and now at 2:30, we will start the next session, third session. So, in between, the participants may have their lunch and all. So, thank you very much for attending this session.